Tonight on 24 Frames, we visit the Wall Art Gallery in Plainview. We sit down with Texas Tech professor and artist, Tina Fuentes. We'll check out some surprisingly impressive work from 16-year-old artist Logan Adair. We run for cover from self-titled blast artist Ronnie Green and Tori Atchison in our South Plain Sessions. It's an art-filled episode of 24 Frames, and it starts right now.
Religion has come into play within my work a lot, as well as women's rights. Those two aspects have always come in and played a very strong, dialogue within the work. But another aspect, I guess, that has filtered in there that I really didn't think about, but I think subconsciously it was there, racial issues, social issues, all of that kind of compounded coming into play. Also the dynamics that I experienced as a child growing up in West Texas. As a child, I can remember developing a friendship with one of my schoolmates, and when I say as a child, I was about first or second grade, and she invited me to her home to come and play with her after school. So we were walking home, and her home was on the way to my home. And so we stopped, and she said, "Well, let me go tell my mom that you're here and we want to play outside." She went inside, and I could hear her mother yelling and saying that no, I was not allowed to be in the house, I wasn't allowed to be in the premises, and she was not going to be playing with me. So she went and slammed the door, and I just stood there, and I thought, well, maybe she's just mad at her daughter. So I waited and waited outside, as a child would do, you know, not understanding that kind of dynamic. It wasn't until I got home, after about 30 minutes, I finally walked home, and I told my mom, and she said, "Well, you can't go over there anymore." And I said, "Why not?" And she just explained. She said, "Well, some people don't like Mexicans, and that's what we are." That was very difficult for me as a child that's about seven. You can speak, as I said, metaphorically, and you can speak about issues, you can speak about things that maybe you are experiencing in life, and there were other people that are experiencing that as well. They are experiencing discrimination in different ways. They are experiencing, you know, the hardships of life in a different manner. They're experiencing the glory of life in a different way. So what a visual artist can do is express what they know best upon that palette, upon that surface, or upon that sculpture, or whatever it is that they're creating, and be able to have that dialogue. For me, as a visual artist, that's the best way that I feel that I speak. That's my language. What it is the visibility of people that is significant and important, and it helps to kind of melt things together and not create such strong, strong boundaries between people. Thank you. I think at an early age, I decided that I was going to be the best that I could be, and that hopefully, you know, people at some point would be able to look beyond the color, they'd be able to look beyond the ethnicity, and to look at either the talent, to look at the abilities, the strengths, the whatever it is that the individual has. And I think part of that is due to the upbringing that I had within my family. Family said, you know, just do the best that you possibly can and move forward. So that's what I've done. It's given me strength in terms of determination, I guess, and also saying that I can move forward. I'm just as good as anyone else, as long as I can prove myself that, you know, I'm talented, I'm knowledgeable, I'm intelligent. I may not be the best of the best, but hey, I'm okay.
On our cards, it says the, you know, West Texas's only contemporary art house, and we have a lot of untraditional art. We have a lot of modern and abstract art. And when people decide to have an art gallery, I don't think they're going to look at the dynamics of Plainview and go, hey, it'll work right there. However, it works. I really think that this rural setting, you have a lot of people here, especially our young people, that have grown up in an area where there is just broad sky, lots of land, and they're not really engaged for the most part in a whole lot of technology. And so they're left with their minds to think and to create and make up stories and draw. And in that kind of setting, you have some things that could be latent. And I found from the tiny children of 4 in pre-K all the way up to the seniors, a real high talent level. And they could express themselves very well through the visual arts. We've been able to draw out some people that have been here a long time. And behind me you see the works of Joseph Garnett, who grew up here. We have Betty Givens, who passed away a year ago, and she was a fantastic local Plainviewan that I don't know that we all really saw the treasure that we had in her. We plan to have a celebration of the folks that are here that have contributed to this town and this area with their life and their art or their literary works. And those things are important. I had a mother and son come in and make an appointment to show me their work. And this young man had a body of work that had been primarily painted in his bedroom. I was just thrilled to be able to have wall space and studio space and be able to offer, hey, look, you know, we have this place and this is what we're here for.
I've been making art pretty much my whole life. I've been painting, just started about this summer. My art teacher at House Center just inspired me to paint because I've been drawing and doing cartoons and stuff. And I just decided to paint like a kid instead. So that's, I think it's more fun than what I would have been doing too. I observed Escher, I love Basquiat, I watch Keith Haring, you see I study art. I just learned about Jean-Michel Basquiat, which is probably the best artist I've ever seen. His stuff was like a kid too, and so I thought, oh wow, I could do this. After I read the comic book series Scott Pilgrim, that inspired me to make my own style of cartoons and things like that, and then that just developed all the way up to, and I still put my characters in my paintings too. I listen to Macklemore, Ryan Lewis, and Fun while I paint too, so that inspires me. I've actually done paintings of both of the groups too. I'm really glad to have a show this early too, just like a couple months in, already having my own show. I'm always going to be an artist of some sort.
The president's car is now turning onto Elm Street. It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade group. Something, I repeat.
The torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans.
You're spoiling me.
Yeah, well, that's the plan.
Miss Audrey, this young lady seems to think you might like to take her on.
The first European language spoken in what would become the United States, Spanish.
I remember them chanting 2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to integrate.
My reaction was, we did it. They said we couldn't, and we did.
Unbelievable!
I feel like an outtake from Ghostbusters.
Jimi Hendrix is one of the most important American musicians of the 20th century.
Now, I wouldn't know a gamma ray if I saw it, but if it sounds good, I'll use it.
I use a brush on some of my paintings, but I also use rifle shots, shotgun shots, guitar strings, all kinds of things to move paint. It's what I call blast art. He began telling me when I was only three. You know, me and a friend used to do a bunch of reloading, and we'd set up targets to make accurate rounds, and we started shooting bottles of water and seeing these explosions, you know, and so I kind of told myself, expensive as this ammunition is, I'm gonna start shooting paint and capturing the explosion. Pretty neat going off out there. I wonder what it looks when you capture it. And that's what I try to do, is capture paint and movement. Or if I'm trying to do like stars in the galaxy or something like that, try to create a background from a vague idea I have, and then I just go from there, and my shots, I try to choose paint to complement the paints before. And usually I don't have a direct objective in my mind, but as it progresses, it just turns out to what it is. And it's like my music. Everybody's not gonna like my music. Everybody's not gonna like my art. Some people are gonna like it a lot. That's just the way things are.
The same story that my grandpa told me. I took him outside.
I played guitar since I was very young. But then later on, when I was raising a family, I thought I was cheating them if I was playing music, because I was spending time and I'd be taking food out of their mouth or something, you know. So I just put it on the back burner for years. And it just means that I can share things that God's done in my life to people. And yeah, so therefore I feel like it's going into the world and planting seeds. Seeds can be words, it can be preaching, but I'm not a preacher and I don't have a good enough memory to remember verses to go out and preach. But I can go into the world and be a witness for what God's done in my life. And that's what the CD is about, just to give him the glory, to give him thanks, and Jesus thanks for laying down his life for me. My mom was a Sunday school teacher, and so yeah, I went to church every time the doors were open in my youth. Then later on in life, we think we get to knowing more than, and that's when I started going down them roads and hitting them brick walls. But those early seeds that were planted is always what we come back to. And sometimes we just have to crash and burn before we really realize that, you know. Well, I tried it, and I tried it, and I tried it again, and there I am. And so I used to go to church, but I was more or less a pew warmer, just there, sitting there thinking what I was going to eat when I got out of church and stuff. And We went to church, but there was not the true meaning there, and I was trying to plant seeds to my kids also. But if you don't put the Lord first, we serve a jealous God, and we stray away, and we're not under His protection when we make our choices. And so, yeah, I had to start my life all over at 49 years old, and that's when I decided to do the CD and tell what had happened through my life, through my prayer, and the answers that I got, and it didn't really come until a significant meaning was there. Christ for you and I.
Where you belong. We all want to find others that share things in common with us. So we begin the journey to find a connection. Someone that we can relate to and can relate to us, all bound together by a common thread. It may not seem like much at first, but as things come into focus, we find ourselves as part of something powerful, something greater than ourselves. We're here. Let's connect.
What we've tried to do in JFK is really explore not only his life, which there's a lot of new material about his life, but also really try to assess what kind of president was he, what kind of pressures was he under. There have been new documents and new information about Kennedy's lifelong problem with his health, what kind of pain he was under, what kind of medication he was often taking. It's eerie how many things that he had to deal with have sort of analogs in our present day. So I think for that, it's both compelling and relevant.
Recently, the story we did on glass artist Lee Ware was nominated for a Lone Star Emmy. We are honored and humbled to share the stories of artists, musicians, and others on the South Plains with you, the viewer. And most importantly, we thank you for tuning in and watching 24 Frames. For more information, visit kttz.org. And remember to tune in Saturday nights at 9 p.m. only on Channel 5.
My name's Tori Acheson, and I come from a family of music from my mother's side. My sister and my mom just always sang and harmonized together, and I love that, but I wanted to take it a little further and write songs to express myself. So it started as kind of getting out of just writing in a journal to getting out melodies and stuff. So that's how I started. I've been playing the Lubbock scene for probably like 15 years. And I think like anything else, music goes in waves. And I think sometimes we're all really strong. And I think something about Lubbock that's unique is the fact that we all have deep connections that have been there for a long time. I think what keeps us together is a community and just watching each other evolve and encouraging one another. I think Lubbock has just this incredible scene of musicians that keep growing and growing, so it encourages me to stick with it. So, I mean, writing music for me comes just from a therapeutic standpoint. I think it's how I emotionally regulate myself. I think it's just how I express myself in the deepest capacity that I can. Music provides that for me, and I think performing live, I'm a little more shy that way than recording, just because it is from such a deep emotional place. I enjoy playing live, and I feel like other people can relate to that, wanting to express themselves emotionally and have a healthy self-expression. I guess the one thing I would really want someone to gain from that is you're not alone. You can express yourself in such a healthy way and feel good about yourself. I'm planning on recording my third album soon, but I'm trying to get with other musicians and really, like with cello and violin, and really get that process going. I want to kind of go back and do open mics where I'm only playing a few songs at a time, getting some more ideas, listening to other people, kind of resting a little bit on it.
Medicated to the ground. see.